Hello and welcome to BYJU'S IAS. Let's take up the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper. The Union Home Minister has said that the use of third degree torture has no place in the modern system of policing. This statement was made by the Home Minister while he was speaking at the 50th Foundation Day of the Bureau of Police Research and Development. The Home Minister has called upon the BPRD to proactively promote the modernization of police forces and transform the police forces, which are generally driven by a fear psychology, and instead make them adopt the service psychology. See, since many decades and centuries, police forces have always been used by the government in order to protect their interests and retain their power by striking fear in the minds of the people. If you look at the British government in India, the police forces were designed to serve the interests of the colonial rule. This fear psychology, which was introduced by the colonial government, has carried over to our police forces post-independence as well. And this colonial hangover can be felt even today. So if police forces are driven by the fear psychology, then cruel and inhuman practices such as torture, phone tapping, illegal detention, etc., they become very prevalent. So such outdated system of policing has no place in a modern society, and hence the Home Minister has called upon the BPRD to proactively play a role in promoting the modernization of police forces. He has called upon the BPRD to train the police forces to rely upon solid investigation skills and collection of forensics evidence in order to build a watertight case instead of relying on outdated methods such as torture, phone tapping, illegal detention, etc. He has also asked the BPRD to work on reforming outdated colonial era laws such as the Indian Penal Code and the Criminal Procedure Code. So in this context, let us talk about the role and the mandate of the Bureau of Police Research and Development. The BPRD was set up in 1970 by the Government of India under the Ministry of Home Affairs, and its primary objective is to promote the modernization of police forces. As a part of this mandate, it takes an active interest in identifying and studying the problems that are affecting the police forces. It also conducts research in order to identify the rapid evolutions that are taking place in the field of science, technology, economy, forensics, and also the changes that are taking place in the society. Through this research, it tries to develop new methods and techniques of training and investigation. So it essentially functions as a research institution and a think tank under the Ministry of Home Affairs, and it has dedicated divisions to deal with research and statistics, to deal with development. It also has a dedicated division for training, which was established based on the recommendations of the Gore Committee on Police Reforms of 1971. It also has a separate department for forensic sciences, and in 1995, it was also given the task to introduce reforms into correctional administration. So as a part of this mandate, the BPRD also looks into prison reforms. Then in 2008, the ambitious National Police Mission was launched under the administrative control of BPRD in order to bring about holistic reforms in India's policing architecture. The mandate of the National Police Mission is to transform India's police forces and make them effective enough to protect India's internal security by inducting the required technology, the required weapons, material, intellectual and organizational resources. Now let's take up the next article. In a major development, the Supreme Court has decided to refer all the petitions related to Article 370 to a 5-judge constitution bench. Multiple petitions have been filed at the Supreme Court challenging the constitutionality of the revocation of special status of Jammu and Kashmir under Article 370. Petitions have been filed which highlight the lack of consent in the reorganization of the state. Petitions have been filed to highlight the suspension of fundamental rights by the government. and petitions have been filed to highlight the curbs imposed on the freedom of the press. So, considering the magnitude and the implications of these petitions, the Supreme Court has decided to refer these petitions to a 5-judge constitution bench of the Supreme Court. During this hearing, the Attorney General, who represents the government, had tried to warn the Supreme Court and he had asked the Supreme Court to exercise restraint in this matter because, according to the government, the proceedings at the Supreme Court will be monitored closely by the United Nations and the international community. And this could have international and cross-border ramifications which could negatively affect India's national interests. But the Supreme Court has rejected this argument of the government and it has said that the Supreme Court is well aware of India's national interests, but it also has a duty to uphold India's constitutional principles. And hence, judicial review cannot be compromised in the name of national interests. Now let's take up the next article. The government has commissioned a new study to identify the microbial diversity along the entire stretch of the Ganga River. The main objective of this study is to identify whether the Ganga River has any microbes which are promoting antibiotic resistance. Developing countries such as India report one of the highest rates of antibiotic resistance amongst bacteria that have been labeled as superbugs. These superbugs have evolved and mutated to develop resistance against basic antibiotics, which are used as the first line of defense against common infections. The emergence of antibiotic resistance amongst bacteria threatens to make the antibiotics ineffective against common infections. Previously, a number of studies have been carried out in small patches of the Ganga River, and extremely high levels of antibiotic resistance has been reported amongst the microbes. But since these studies were partial, the government is looking to understand the microbial diversity of the Ganga River across its entire length. As a part of the study, microbe samples will be taken across the entire stretch of the Ganga River and their genomes will be sequenced and mapped. This study is being taken up under the National Mission for Clean Ganga and it will try to identify the different sources of E. coli infection. E. coli is a type of gut bacteria which is commonly found in humans and animals and it is responsible for causing gastrointestinal diseases and for promoting antibiotic resistance. Now let's take up an editorial from page number 10 which highlights and analyzes the key developments that took place at the recently concluded G7 summit. As far as India is concerned, the biggest development is that it got invited as a special invitee by France. This invitation gave an opportunity to Prime Minister Modi to clarify a few issues with the United States over its stand on the Kashmir issue. Over the last 1 month, President Trump has made a few controversial statements with regard to the Kashmir issue. First, he made an offer to mediate between India and Pakistan over the Kashmir conflict. And then he had expressed concern about the human rights situation in Jammu and Kashmir after India revoked the special status of Jammu and Kashmir. These controversial statements made by President Trump was in complete contradiction to India's stand that the Kashmir issue is an internal matter to India. So the G7 summit and the invitation to India gave an opportunity to Prime Minister Modi to clear the air with President Trump. And it appears that the United States has backed away from these controversial statements and it has come to accept that the Kashmir issue is an internal matter to India. So this definitely represents a major diplomatic victory for India. And along with this, both the sides appear to have made some progress with regard to their trade disputes. The trade negotiations between the two sides has hit a deadlock over the last few months. But some progress seems to have been achieved because the leaders of both the countries have agreed to push for negotiations between their trade representatives. The G7 summit also gave an opportunity to Prime Minister Modi to speak about India's commitments to the Climate Change Convention. He could also highlight India's efforts in harnessing solar power through the International Solar Alliance. And he also spoke about the need to eliminate single-use plastic for the sake of environment protection. But it is very interesting to note that the United States, which has quit the Paris Agreement, did not participate in these discussions on climate change and environment protection. And this clearly shows the divide amongst the developed countries on crucial topics such as global warming, climate change, environment protection, etc. The next major development was that France had invited the Iranian foreign minister to participate in the G7 summit. This was very significant considering the tensions between US and Iran. But despite this major development, the other members of the G7, they refused to discuss the Iranian nuclear deal or the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action with the Iranian foreign minister. This was mainly at the insistence of the United States because the US has quit the Iranian nuclear deal, and this is the primary reason behind the increasing tensions between US and Iran. After quitting the nuclear deal, the US has reimposed economic sanctions against Iran, but the European countries have failed to diffuse these tensions. So this divide was clearly evident at the G7 summit. And then the United States pushed for a proposal seeking the re-entry of Russia into the G7. See, prior to 2014, the G7 was known as the G8 because even Russia was a member of the grouping. But after Russia annexed Crimea and after tensions started increasing between Russia and the Western countries, Russia had been expelled from the G8 and the group had returned to the G7 format. But President Trump has been pushing a proposal at the G7 seeking the re-entry of Russia, but this discussion was rejected by the other members of the G7. Then the G7 has also discussed the massive forest fires that have destroyed the Amazonian rainforest, and they even announced a financial assistance of $20 million for Brazil. But this financial assistance has been rejected by Brazil because of its diplomatic dispute with France over the issue of forest fires. And for the first time in the history of G7, there was no joint statement which was issued at the end of the summit. And this clearly highlights the divide amongst the members of the G7. Now let's take up an editorial which deals with the topic of honor killing. Honor killing is a brutal practice of killing young couples in the name of protecting the so-called honor of their family, their caste, and their community. Young couples who are seeking to marry outside their caste or outside their religion are brutally killed by their own family members in the name of protecting the so-called honor of their family, their caste, and their religion. This medieval practice and brutal crime is still witnessed in India because of the belief of some family members that marriages should take place within their caste and their community. These orthodox beliefs have been further strengthened because of the prevalence of arranged and forced marriages in the Indian society. These outdated practices continue to prevail in the Indian society despite the observation of the Supreme Court that freedom of marital choice is a fundamental right. The Supreme Court has also observed that there is no honor in honor killing, and such murders should fall under the rarest of the rare category. Despite such observations, reports of honor killing continue to emerge from different parts of the country, and the editorial refers to a recent case in Kerala. In this particular case, a young Christian couple were targeted by their own family members just because the groom was a Dalit Christian. The biggest irony over here is that the caste system, which is an outcome of the Varna system in Hinduism, has been transferred to Christianity as well. Those Hindus who have converted to Christianity, they have taken their caste system along, And this highlights the regressiveness that is still prevalent in the Indian society. So in this context, the editorial says that there is an urgent need for a stringent law to be passed by the center and the states, which would provide for strict punishment for those who commit murders in the name of family honor. Recently, the government of Rajasthan has passed such a law against honor killing, and the center and the other states need to draw inspiration from this. Such a proactive legislative intervention is urgently needed because even young and educated individuals are getting associated with their caste identity. This resurgence in the identity of caste and religion poses a grave threat to the Indian society. And as Dr. B.R. Ambedkar said, if we have to annihilate caste, we need to promote interfaith and intercaste marriages. Next, we have two columns in the editorial page. One column analyzes the transfer of RBI surplus to the government, which has been covered in detail in our yesterday's analysis. Then we have another column which deals with the communication shutdown in Kashmir, which has been discussed multiple times over the last few weeks. So instead, let's take up an important column written by Arun Myra from the op-ed page. The writer begins by making a very interesting argument. He says that the progress of human civilization is directly related to the evolution of our governance institutions. So in this context, he says that the evolution of electoral democracy in the Western countries has transformed the human civilization. See, modern electoral democracy started to evolve in Western countries such as the United Kingdom, France, United States, etc. These countries championed the cause of democracy and they even started to export the ideology of democracy. But today, it appears that democracy is failing in these countries mainly because of the weakening of institutions and the lack of connect between the government formal institutions and the public. The writer refers to a recently published article by The Economist, which was titled, Are Western Democracies Becoming Ungovernable? This question has become very relevant today because across the world, we have a number of popularly elected governments which are advocating undemocratic policies. We have elected governments in office which do not enjoy real power. In such cases, the power is actually exercised by the non-elected. We have instances wherein the largest elected party does not have majority in the house, and as a result, the coalition governments which are formed promote instability, and this leads to policy paralysis. Then finally, we have elected parliaments whose functioning has been disrupted and they have more or less become defunct. This harsh conclusion can be drawn by looking at the Brexit crisis in the United Kingdom and the deadlock in the US Congress. So in the light of these developments, the writer says that the model of democracy has started to fail in the Western countries. In comparison to these Western countries, democracy appears to be shining in India. This appearance is because India has a strong government which has provided for stability. A record number of bills have been passed in the parliament recently, and this gives us an appearance that democracy in India is truly shining. But the question is, can democracy be just defined as the conduct of free and fair elections and as the presence of a strong and stable government and a functioning parliament? Is a country truly democratic just because elections are conducted regularly and just because you have a functioning government and a parliament? The answer to this question is a clear no, because a strong government will always promote a majoritarian democracy. In such a democracy, only the voices of the majority are heard, whereas the minorities are conveniently ignored. So the writer says that such a model of governance is nothing but authoritarianism, which has been disguised as a functioning democracy. He says that if true democracy has to be achieved, then a strong government needs to be balanced by strong institutions. Because strong institutions, they act as the pillars of democracy. These are the pillars which can promote good governance and people's participation, and this can keep a check on the authoritarian tendencies of a strong government. So in this context, the writer prescribes a recipe for a healthy democracy, and he says that there are three layers of institutions which are needed to create and promote a healthy democracy. In this model, the bottom layer is occupied by public space and the media, which promotes free speech, people's participation, and activism. Then at the top layer, we have the constitutional and formal institutions, such as the parliament, judiciary, etc. But we have already seen that the constitutional and formal institutions have already failed to deliver on their responsibility. And even the bottom layer has more frequently misused its powers of free speech and activism. So it is in this context that we need a middle or an intermediate layer in the form of semi-official institutions which can bring the top and the bottom layers together. Such a middle or intermediate layer can promote further interaction between the formal and the informal layers, and this can result in the establishment of a true democracy. Next, we have an article on page 22, which refers to the 18th Conference of Parties of the CITES Convention. CITES stands for Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species on Wild Fauna and Flora. This international convention provides for regulation of international trade in endangered species. This regulation is achieved by placing the endangered species into three different lists known as Appendix 1, Appendix 2, and Appendix 3. Amongst these three categories, Appendix 1 enjoys the highest degree of protection. During the 18th Conference of Parties, India had proposed to upgrade the protection of endangered species such as the star tortoise, the smooth-coated otter, and the small-clawed otter. These proposals of India have been accepted, and currently these species have been upgraded and they have been placed under Appendix 1 of the CITES Convention. Now let's take up the practice questions. Which of the following species have been listed as vulnerable by the IUCN? The correct answer is option D, the Indian star tortoise, the Asian small-clawed otter, and the smooth-coated otter. All the three have been listed as vulnerable on the red data list of IUCN. So option D is the right answer. Now let's take up the second question. Which of the following statements are correct? Under the CITES Convention, international trade in Appendix 1 species is completely prohibited with a few exceptions. Under Appendix 2, international trade is allowed but regulated. Both the statements are correct. Option C is the right answer. Now let's take up the third question. Which of the following statements are correct? E. coli bacteria can cause serious food poisoning in their hosts. It is mainly transmitted through the fecal-oral route. Again, both the statements are correct. Option C is the right answer. Now let's take up a map-based question. The Subansiri River is shared between which states? The correct answer is option C. It is shared between Assam and Arunachal Pradesh. In fact, Subansiri is one of the tributaries of the Brahmaputra River. Now let's take up a question from the 2015 prelims paper. Which one of the following is the national aquatic animal of India? The correct answer is the gangetic dolphin. Option C is the right answer. Finally, let's take up a couple of mains practice questions. The first question, incidents of honor killing are a disgrace to the Indian society. Comment. The second question, a functioning democracy is not determined by just the timely conduct of elections. Elaborate. So please write an answer to these questions and post them in the comment section below. This concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.